Hello, my name is Liam. I'm the export sales manager for DCS. Welcome to DCS. It's been a pleasure to have Leo here today. He has seen our manufacturing facility, which is all takes place in this building behind me. We have our research and development team here as well. We have our service team, we have our marketing team, we have everything to do with DCS is in this building behind me. I've been with DCS for just over 10 years now, so loving every second of it. We genuinely make world-class life-enhancing products, and I can't wait to show Leo the listing facility, and we have our complete product portfolio on display here. So we're about to go inside and have a lot of fun in the demo room and listen to some really cool tracks. So.
Hi, I'm Dan Thomas. I'm the production supervisor here at DCS, and I'm going to show you around the production area. So to start, we start with one of our kits. So this is a kit that we get from our kitting company. This kit has all of the electronics and the basic metalwork in order to build a unit to a programmable and testable state. So the production team will grab one of these kits and they will take it to their bench, and then they will build it to this stage. So here we have a Vivaldi DAC. So it consists of a control board, our DAC board, which is what we're known for. While we're building the unit, all of the serial numbers are logged on a works order build record with a serial number. Then once it is built to this stage, we will program the unit. We program the control board. Then we program all of the network stage. And then we load the latest software in to make sure, we're the latest testable software. Then we will get one of our colleagues to come and double check the unit to make sure that there are no loose cables, no loose screws, no missing screws, no issues with the unit whatsoever. So that's our first quality control. Once the unit is updated, then we go to our next stage, which is our first test, which is the auto test station. So we'll go over to the auto test station. So once the unit is built, then it's going to get soaked for 48 hours. When we say soaked, what we mean is power cycled for 48 hours, just to make sure that any of the components that may be faulty should have an issue within those 48 hours. So these are our auto test stations. So auto test tests all of the inputs, all of the outputs at all of the different frequencies that we use. So what we do is we do an auto test at the start, just to prove that all of the electronics that have come in are working. So that once that's passed and it goes to the 48 hour soak, we know that before the soak, the boards were all working. And this is just so that we don't lose 48 hours on a board that may have came in with an issue. So if it passes auto test one, then it moves down to our soak racks. So this is where it sits for 48 hours with a timer. It's going to stay on here for 2 days. During the day, it is powered up for the whole day. Then overnight, we power cycle it every 15 minutes. So every 15 minutes, the unit turns off and turns back on. And we'll have an input that switches between 44 and 48K so that the DAC board is switching between the two sections on the DAC board to make sure that the whole of the unit is powered fully and power cycled. Essentially, what we're trying to do here is break the unit if it is likely to have any faults. After 48 hours, an alarm goes off and tells us to come and put the unit back on auto test for the second time. So we will run the second auto test, then it's going to test all of the same inputs, all the same outputs as it did previously, and it should pass. It usually passes. If it passes this stage, then we go to our next stage, which is the bench test. So we'll come over to our bench test area. So at this stage, we have a test script that we're just going to run through. This stage acts as our first gate or door. And this stops any unit that hasn't passed auto test from progressing any further. So we want to make sure it doesn't go any further if it's not ready to do so. So the first thing we do on this is we enter the serial number of the unit. Then that checks the auto test stations to make sure that it has a pass result. If it's got a pass result, then it allows us to do the rest of the bench test. So with the bench test, it's we're checking anything that the auto tests can't test. So things like pressing the buttons, turning the volume knob. There's a couple of bits on the DAC board that we need to trim in. So we trim the AC voltage out, and we're going to log all of that. Then that gets saved in the same file as the auto test station. So we've got a record of all of the different stages, all of the different tests, all of the different pass or fail results, things like that. So once the unit has passed this stage, then that unit comes to our racks here. And these racks are our 7-day lead racks, we call them. So these are basically stock units that are ready for a customer. So when we say 7-day lead, the idea is that we have a set of units that are ready to go. When we get an order for a unit, then what we do is we build a unit to replace the unit that we're about to take. So we build the unit, put it on auto test because it gets this 48 hours soak, and then we come and then we take one of these, we get the order sheet that tells us the customer, the destination country, the voltage, the color of the unit. We take that sheet down to stores, get all of the metalwork, bring it back up, and then we come over to the desks and we will we'll put all of the cladding material on. And doing it this way with the stock and the 48 hours, it just speeds the process up. It means we don't have to wait 2 days for the unit to be ready to be clad. We have one already here. So we will take one of these units. I don't think we've got anyone cladding at the minute, unfortunately. But we will come to one of our desks. So we've got young Mark here, who is building a Rossini clock. So we will put all of the metalwork onto the unit. Then before we put the top plate on, we will check over the whole unit. We will make sure that all of the screws, all of the cables are all 100% plugged in. Nothing's loose, nothing's missing. Then we will ask a colleague to come and check that unit again. So they're going to do the same thing. So everything gets checked by two different people, so that we're 100% sure that the quality is perfect. Once the top plate has gone on and the unit is finished, then we come over to our sound check area. So here we have a Rossini DAC that is about to be sound checked. So the sound check, it's not a critical listening stage. We're just checking that everything is working again. The auto test stations are excellent at picking all faults up. They test hundreds of different tests. But one of the things it can't pick up is between frequency changes and between input changes, the unit is muted for a second so that it doesn't pick up erroneous clicks and pops. So what the only things the autotest can't pick up is clicks and pops and noises between those stages. So on the sound check, we're listening for anything like that. We're making sure that all of the buttons are still working, making sure all of the screen's working, make sure there hasn't been any damage to the unit while we were cladding it. We will go through the whole test procedure, listening to some music, which is always good. If we're happy with it, then we have a serial log that gets logged. We log all of the serial numbers, who built the unit, who clad the unit, so we always have a record of that. Then we print all of the serial labels of the, so that's the serial number with the destination country, colours, voltage, things like that. So this stage we also change the voltage of the unit so that the unit is sound checked at the voltage of the destination country. So we know that when it gets plugged in to wherever it's going, it is going to work, definitely. So if we're happy with that stage, then we go to our next stage, which is our inspection area. So these units are units that have had all of their cladding, all of their testing is complete. So we're going to check these units to make sure that they are 100% before they go in a box. So the first thing one of the guys will do is they will put the unit here. They will pat test the unit and they will flash test the unit, and then they will log that they've done that. Then they're going to roll the whole unit around, clean it, and make sure it is perfect. There can't be any dings, any scratches, any dust in the screen, nothing. It's got to be 100% perfect. They will check all of the serial labels and the serial numbers on the unit, on the labels, on the back of the unit, that all match up. And they're going to check all of the colours of every single panel all match up, because when you anodize parts, it's notoriously difficult to get color match perfect. It's all done on times. So a fascia might take 45 seconds to get to a very specific color, whereas the side cheek that is much lighter might only take 12 seconds. And it's all done by hand. So it's very difficult to get the anodizing colors right. So we're going to check to make sure that they are all perfect. So once one of the production team are happy that that unit is perfect, we will get a second member of the production team to come over, and they're going to do the same. So they're going to look over the whole unit, make sure everything is perfect. Again, colours, no marks, serial numbers all match up, everything is perfect. Then they'll sign the build record. When they're happy with it, then we call a third member of staff from either sales or marketing, and they're going to come and do the same again. So they're going to check all of the unit, everything is perfect, all the serial labels match up, there's no scratches, there's no marks, there's no dings, it is perfect. So when three people are happy with that, then it's ready to get packed. So we will clean the whole unit again, we will put all of the shipping protection, like the display window stickers, all of the dust caps, things like that on. Then it'll get put into a moleskin bag, and then it will get put into one of our custom boxes. So we have these boxes. So these will have the unit, all of the manuals, all of the cable sets, the power leads, everything like that. So we will follow our guide and our paperwork to see what needs to be in here. We will then get a second member of staff to come and double check to make sure all of the cables, all of the manuals, everything is nice and neat and nothing is missing from this box. Then it is ready to get closed up and we put the serial labels on. And then that's ready to be dispatched to dispatch for shipping. So that is the two channel area. Then we have our head fly area. So this is our head fly production area. So the head fly is a little different to the two channel. This is designed to be built as much quicker because we do higher numbers of these. So with these, we will grab two kits. So we have one kit with all of the electronics in, and we have another kit with all of the metalwork in. So all of our electronics, where our two channel kits, we soak for 2 days. Our head fly section, our head fly kits, all of our electronics are soaked for us at the manufacturers. So that saves us 2 days. Having all of the metalwork in one box, that saves us having to go and get it out of stores. It can all get put together, and this is roughly an hour to put together and test. So the guys will grab both these kits. Here we have a headphone amplifier being put together. So this unit will go together. It's already pre-programmed by our suppliers, so we don't need to worry about that either. So we will use our build procedures to show us how these units go together if we ever need them. So once this unit is all built, again, we check it, and we will get a colleague to check it as well. So we have Paul here, who is putting a DAC together, I believe. So this is, Paul's just putting the metalwork on this unit. So you have the main shell, then you have the front and the rears will go on. Like I said, so once it is finished, he will call someone over and they will check the unit to make sure there's no missing screws, no loose screws, everything's plugged in, and all of the metalwork is okay. So once this has been built, this can go straight to the auto test station. So we have our Lino auto test stations here. This is going to test everything similar to how the two channel auto test stations worked, testing all the inputs, all the outputs, things like that. Once the auto test has passed, which is roughly 15 to 20 minutes, then if it's a clock, it's ready to have, it just needs a bench test. If it's a headphone or a headphone amplifier or a DAC, then it needs to go to soundcheck first. So that goes to our soundcheck area, the same as all of our other units. That will be soundchecked, serial numbers logged, things like that. The clocks get bench tested, and that is just going to check that the crystal has been calibrated correctly, and just to log a few serial numbers and things like that. Then it will come to our final stage. So the unit will get PAT tested and flash tested, the same as any other unit. It will get inspected by the first person. They're going to roll it around again, make sure it's 100% perfect, make sure it's all clean, no scratches, no fingerprints, no marks. When they're happy, it will get second-eyed. So we will call a colleague. They will do the same. They're going to clean it. They're going to make sure that they're happy with it, and everyone gets signed. We then scan the works order to make sure that it has had all of its auto test passes, and this will tell us, they'll say okay to pack. If it's okay to pack, then we can pack the unit. So again, we have custom Lena boxes, which are quite similar to our other boxes, but a nice fancy box. So when it arrives with you, get a nice fancy box. And the same again, this is just gonna be packed in a custom bag and then dropped in the box. We will put all of the manuals, all of the cable sets for whichever country it is going to. And then again, we're gonna have a colleague come and check the box, make sure that everything is perfect. And when we're happy, then they get palletized. They get put on a pallet, big pallet of 20 units, and then it's wrapped up and it's ready to get shipped. So here we have Colin is putting a Bartok onto auto test. So Colin is going to plug in all of the inputs, all of the outputs. The RS232 is going to control the unit throughout the whole of the auto test. We have a USB stick that has all different frequency music on it, and that's going to play all different frequency tracks during the test. This is going to be checking all of the clocking, all of the inputs and outputs, all the digital inputs, all of the analog outputs, the digital outputs. Then when we set this off, we have all our auto test stations. So we have a generator, which generates the audio. We have an APX, which does a lot of the testing. And then we have an analog to digital converter. So where our units are digital to analog converters, we've then got the analog sound that we then convert back to digital so that we can monitor all of the information that the auto testers are giving us. And here we have a unit on test. So this is just giving us a graph, or various information. Normally, production wouldn't really need any of this. We just need the pass or fail results. In the rare instance where something fails, then all of this information can be used by the service team or R&D if needed to try and figure out what the issue is with the unit and where we went wrong or where the unit's gone wrong, really. So it's quite rare, but lots of information is always useful. So here we have our climactic chamber. So all the clocks that we make at DCS need to be calibrated so that they are accurate within 1 PPM. So we will put a clock inside this climactic chamber, then we'll run this overnight. And this is gonna take the temperature from I think 0 degrees up to 45 degrees, 50 degrees, all the way back down. And the whole time that we're running that script is going to be taking measurements and calibrating the crystal. And this ensures that the crystal, no matter where we go, where the unit goes in the world, that clock is going to be accurate to within 1 PPM. So here we are running a cycle. As you can see, currently we're at minus 10 degrees. So here we have our fascias, all different stages of how they come. So this is our solid billet of aluminium. So these come in and we inspect these to make sure that we can't see any cores from where they've been extruded, make sure there's no faults with the actual metalwork. Then we send it to our machinists, and in the machine shop, they will put it on a CNC machine and they will mill it out. And they will cut all of these little ribs. And this is from this on both sides. So it gets cut out on both sides. This then comes back to us and we inspect it again. So we're inspecting this to make sure that there are no marks or dings or anything that are going to show up through the anodizing. We then send the fascia to our anodizers, and they will put the finish on. So this is the silver finish. This goes through several processes, through it gets anodized, goes through the brightener. This then comes back to us again, then we inspect it again to make sure that it is perfect. Once it's been inspected, then we send it to our silt screeners, and this is where they're going to silt screen all of the writing onto the fascia. Then once that comes back to us, it gets inspected again and put into stores, and then inspected again before we fit it to a unit, and then inspected again once it's on the unit before it gets boxed.
So, welcome Leo. My name's David Stephen. I'm Managing Director of DCS, Data Conversion Systems, and we are based here in our factory in Cambridge, UK. So the company has been around since 1987. Started originally as a spin-out from Cambridge Consultants. It was the Converter Group from Cambridge Consultants who began to do chip design for radar and telecoms. That technology was used in the Sea Harrier radar system in the First Gulf War. Had a number of applications in broadcast, and then from there the founders of the company moved into professional test and measurement equipment, and most of that was based around analog to digital technology. So our A to D technology from the radar side had such a low noise floor that it was especially useful in professional recording and test and measurement environments. So from there, the company, I think, because the founders, Mike and Duncan and Andy, as one of the employees, were big lovers of music, got really excited by what was happening in professional recording and mastering. So the first boxes that we made were the 900 series, and they were analog to digital converters. From there, we moved into digital to digital converters, which were really to take those digitized bits we'd recorded in a studio and convert them to ones and zeros at a higher sample rate. So some of the original DCS D2D converters were used by people like Sony and Philips to create Super Audio CD, to create the world's first 2488 to 2496, 24192. We were then instrumental in the creation of DSD as a format. So again, our format converters supported the advent of DSD. So we've really pioneered recording and playback since the late 80s. And really our philosophy's always been about linearity and low distortion and being a piece of glass to the music. You know, really at the end of the day, we're an engineering-led company who is focused on converting ones and zeros into music. So music that you can see, you can feel, and you can get the true essence of what the artist is trying to get across to you, the listener. That's really what we're about. It's what drives us every day, is this continuous improvement in both measure performance, but also in that subjective sonic, you know, how it feels, how it makes you feel. So that's a two-pronged approach. We are continually trying to push the state of the art. And we do that mostly through our own hardware and software. So one of the things I think that makes DCS stand apart from a lot of other audio companies is that entire signal path from end to end, we have experience and we have expertise. So we've been in the analog to digital recording game for a long time. We helped to pioneer technologies in that space. And now we are focused on the playback end, on D to A, and clocking and upsampling and filtering and everything that's important to what you hear through your loudspeakers. So We can only do that through our own proprietary technology. And because we have control of the signal from the point of input to the point of analog output on the DAC, and there's a lot we can do. There's a lot we've achieved, but there's a lot more still to come. And that's part of the fun of working at DCS, is trying to create amazing systems that inspire people and entertain people and connect them with the music. So it's something that we, you know, we really enjoy doing and we're passionate about. And it's fantastic when we see our products, you know, make their way to countries such as Taiwan, which, you know, people really appreciate the music there, and we've been successful there, and we always enjoy getting feedback from audiophiles in Taiwan. So yeah, it's great to have you here. Yeah, so the product family at DCS, everything that we build shares the same DNA. And when I talk about DNA, I mean the same approach to signal processing, the same approach to D2A, to clocking, to power supply. So it really, what we try to do is every product starts from a blank sheet, and it's a case of, okay, how do we get what we think is a DCS level of performance from this box that we're trying to build. Now, at the reference end of the product family is Vivaldi, and that's either a 3-box or a 4-box system. Depends on how you listen to music. If you spin discs, CDs and SACDs, then you use a transport. If you stream, then you start with an upsampler, and then you need a D2A converter and a master clock. And we found that by separating out those key functions, there's a appreciable difference in sound and what you hear and what you feel. So it's really easy to demonstrate. There's technical reasons why separating the clock into a, you know, galvanically isolated box that has its own internal clock reference makes a difference. And there's also, again, separating the D2A from the upsampling and the first order filtering has a difference. So we found over the years that, you know, that gets you to a level of performance that can produce amazing results. And then it's about, you know, we have a proprietary ring DAC, which we improved recently with the Apex version, which Chris can talk to you more about. We have our own proprietary signal processing when it comes to upsampling, filtering, clocking. And it's when you combine everything that you get that DCS sound. I think it's a unique sound because it's our own software and our own hardware. We're not bringing in chips from other silicon providers. And what we do is we take that technology that we've developed for Vivaldi and to push the state of the art, and then we look at ways we can adapt it, that technology, and build new products. So from Vivaldi came Rossini. And Rossini was a DAC, Rossini DAC, or a Rossini CD player with a Rossini clock. We then took that technology and said, okay, how can we compact it more? And from there, we developed Bartok DAC. But with Bartok DAC, we then took a kind of a different path and said, okay, we can see that there's a lot of audiophiles who also like to listen to music on headphones. How can we develop a headphone stage that works very well with our analog output stage on the ring DAC and create great sound from headphones? So we developed the Bartok headphone DAC. That was hugely successful. We had a lot of great feedback from audiophiles and from headphiles on what they listened to, the headphones they used, what kind of drive they needed. And that gave us the idea to develop the Lina range of electronics. So Lina was, again, the challenge was, how do you take the electronics that's in a 4-box Vivaldi system, or a 3-box minus the transport, and get that into a half chassis that can be used for headphone playback or for two channel. So that became a real mechanical and electronic engineering challenge, because it was, how do we take that DCS technology, those different DCS PCBs, and how do we get them into one flex rigid fold up PCB inside one single chassis? And that was where Lina DAC and Lina Clock came from. And then we took what we learned from the Bartok headphone DAC and we built the outboard Lina headphone amplifier. So there's always a kind of genealogy across the product ranges, from how we take ideas and technologies from one range and we like to bring them down into the other products. It's something that we believe in strongly. If you invest in DCS, it's a journey, and we like to go on a journey with our customers. So if you invested in an original Vivaldi at the point that we launched, the performance now is light years ahead of where it was at launch. And I don't think there's many audio companies can say that from the point of launch to now, the product has, you know, improved so much. And that's really down to the engineering team and how talented they are, that it's a platform that we build on. And when we launch, it's the beginning, and we're always looking at ways to improve our products through updates, through adding new streaming services, through adding new mapping algorithms for the Ring DAC, adding different sample rate support, different file formats. And then actually the latest and probably the greatest update that we had to Vivaldi, Rossini and Bartok was Apex, which was a hardware upgrade. Now that would only have been possible with the mapper update that we did a couple of years before, because that let the Ring run at a higher speed, which then enabled Chris to prototype the new Ring DAC board. So everything kind of works hand in hand, software, mechanical, hardware design, and it's always about trying to improve, trying to keep push the state of the art, not just in terms of measure performance, but in terms of how our products sound. And I think that's, again, the real skill that our team have, that they intuitively know where to focus their effort and what design trade-offs to make. And if they improve linearity, then they'll get more detail, more resolution. If they can improve jitter performance, then, yeah, they might get better timing and image separation. But it's that, you know, where to focus efforts and where to make trade-offs, that's I think the real skill in engineering. And our team have 30 plus years of experience, so for every successful product and feature that you see, there's a lot of frustrations and failed projects and things that we haven't managed to do. But again, that's for me part of the excitement of working at DCS, that we're always trying to, you know, push the boundaries of what our products can do and delight customers, and to get feedback from happy listeners and from musicians and recording professionals about what our products can do and how close it gets into the music. That's what drives us on. Great question. What does the future hold? So it's something, as a digital company and as a company that prides itself on innovation and performance, I think you've always got to be looking to the future. You know, always looking 3, 5, 7 years out. Where is the market going? How are people listening to music? And if I look back first, you know, we can see that people are moving from silver disc, from CD, from SACD to computer-based music. Initially, that was connecting a computer on USB. Then it was streaming from a NAS drive. Now it's streaming from online services. Now it's things like Apple AirPlay and the Kinect model, where you use the native app of the streaming service. It's other pieces of software like Rune. So for us now, it's about interoperability. Really, we want ones and zeros. And when we get ones and zeros and we can control the flow of those ones and zeros, we think we can do an amazing job at converting them to music. So one part of the company's focused on innovation and enhancements in user experience and interoperability and new services, and making sure that we can support how people want to listen to music. The other part of the company is focused on new technologies and improvements in our own hardware and software, so that we can support new sample rates or file formats if they come around, so that we can improve measure performance, jitter, the analog performance, and the sound. And sometimes with those projects, we look at it more as working on technologies, and then can we deliver those technologies in existing products? So I think Apex was a result of that, where it was a kind of exploration by Chris. He discovered something and we were able to engineer it into Bartók, Rossini, Vivaldi. So in a way, we're maybe not like a typical company where we have a product roadmap and the products have a life cycle and we're already working on the replacement when we launch. It's more about, where do we think audio is going? What can we do with our technology? What can we add to it? How can we improve it? And then how do we get that across everything? Because again, for us, the backwards compatibility between product ranges is important to us, and also taking customers on that journey. So I think this year we've already released an update for the Lina DAC, so that it has variable volume control and can work in a two-channel system. We have a number of Mosaic enhancements coming to improve UPnP playback, to add a couple of new services, to improve the user experience. We had the Apex update. Again, there's maybe some software improvements to the Vivaldi, Rossini and Bartók DAC that we're working on. So it's exciting. There's always a lot happening. Sometimes that's software updates, sometimes that's hardware updates, but really it's that continual push, continual quest for improvement. So I think, what does the future hold? That depends on how people listen to music, but we're always trying to anticipate that and always trying to deliver great sound. So we want ones and zeros. We want to create great sound, and everything that happens in between, we're always working on.
Hello, my name's Chris Hales and I'm the Director of Product Development here at DCS. I've been with DCS for nearly 25 years now. So, I've been through the mill a bit, but know a little bit about what goes on here. In any case, I'd like to talk to you about the Ring DAC, which is our unique technology that we have. One of the most important aspects of DAC performance is its linearity. If you don't have good linearity, it causes distortion products of one sort or another, and they particularly mess up the performance at low signal levels, add a graininess to that sometimes, but certainly with our DAC, with the Ring DAC, you get very good linearity, which means the low-level performance is very clear, the detail is very transparent, which of course is exactly what we want as music fans. So here is our Ring DAC board, and as you can see, it's really quite busy. We have two programmable devices here which look after one of the key functions of our Ring DAC technology. We have an array of current sources over here, which is the sort of heart of the D2A process. And then we have our analog filtering, summing stages and output stages on the top half of the board as you're looking at it. The way the Ring DAC operates in very simplistic terms is that it has a number of current sources, I've pointed out to them on the board, which are all of equal value. And depending on the voltage which we want to represent, we turn on more of them or fewer of them. So the more current sources turned on, the higher the voltage, the fewer, the lower the voltage. The key aspect or the key trick here is that there are actually more current sources than we ever need to represent any particular voltage level. And that means that if we want to represent a voltage level of 2 volts, let's say for sake of argument, we don't have to use the same set of current sources for every sample. And what that means is that we can intelligently choose which current sources to use depending on how often they've used before and so forth. And in doing so, we effectively average out any errors in the values of those current sources, because unfortunately in the real world, no two resistors are identical, no two current sources are identical. And that's just a fact of life we have to live with. But by having more than we need, by choosing cleverly which ones we use for each sample, we can get extremely good linear performance, which is exactly what we all want and what DCS is known for. This board has been through a number of iterations. This is probably, well, it's got version 6 written on the board, and they've probably been 4 or 5 iterations of each of the previous versions. So we've gone through quite a few now. This is the Apex version, which incorporates our latest set of enhancements to that. What we did with the Apex version was to have a very careful look at the performance of each stage of the ring DAC, from the mapping function, the performance of the current sources themselves, the performance of the reference which supplies the current sources, and the behavior of the analog stages subsequently. It's quite hard to improve performance when the performance is already regarded as the best in the world. But we found a few things we thought we could improve upon, and we spent a lot of time and effort doing just that. So one of the key improvements is in the reference power supply, which supplies the current sources. There's a direct relationship between the number of artifacts, the number of unwanted components in the output, and the quality of that reference supply. So by improving it, we automatically and immediately improve the analog performance. Looking at the output stages here, we had a careful look at each one of them, identified where the sources of non-linearity were. And bear in mind, as I say, they're very low already. So typically we were looking at minus 110 dB of distortion components compared to the fundamental signal. We've improved that by 15 to 20 dB. So that's quite a big improvement, but there wasn't much to start with. So as I say, we looked at all of those stages, improved the distortion where we saw there was margin to improve it. We've also had a look at the timing of the digital signal, which is what actually controls the current sources we've been talking about. Timing is also very crucial to good D2A performance. So we had a good look at that and improved a few of the jitter parameters there, so that the clocking to the current sources is more uniform, is more accurate, and the performance itself is more linear. And I think that's about it for Apex.
Hi, my name is James Cook. I'm the head of customer service for DCS Audio. I've been with the company about 3.5 years now, so I joined in February of 2020. And I look after anything technical really within the company. So I deal with customer and dealer distributor inquiries that we get through about DCS products. I also lead a lot of the technical training at DCS, so helping our distribution network learn more about DCS products and provide the best level of service to our customers. So I'm going to talk to you a little bit about some of the technology that goes into DCS products and a little bit about what that means to the customer. So I'll start with the Lina DAC, the Bartok DAC, and the Rossini DAC. These are three of our fantastic all-in-one units. So all of these comprise of a streamer, a preamplifier. We have an upsampler built into all of them, as well as the DAC. And these can be connected up to a variety of systems. So they can be used in a two-channel system. They can be used in headphone systems as well with an external headphone amplifier. So we have very, very powerful streaming capabilities built into all of these DACs. This is the same as well with the Vivaldi range, but with the Vivaldi, we have the streaming capabilities are in a second unit with the Vivaldi upsampler. And in terms of streaming, we have the same functionality with all of these units. So within the DCS Mosaic app, you can access Tidal, Cobuz, Deezer, internet radio, podcasts, and then you can use Tidal Connect and Spotify Connect to play directly from those apps to the units, as well as using Apple AirPlay, and it's fully Roon ready as well, so being able to play from Roon. And as part of being a modern audio company, we keep a close eye on the streaming market to see if there are any new streaming services which are emerging, which we can integrate into our products. All of the products have preamplifier functionality built in as well. So in March, I believe, of this year, we released the Lena 1.1 update, which brought preamp functionality to the Lena unit. And it's present on all of the rest of the product range as well. So this is a digital volume control, as well as a variable output voltage. That means that the unit can be connected either to a preamplifier, if that's what the customer wants in their system, or it can be connected directly to a power amplifier, if the customer wants to go direct, or to a headphone amplifier as well. The upsampling, that's quite a big thing with the DCS product as well. So that forms part of what we call the digital processing platform within DCS products. And the digital processing platform is a combination of several bits of DCS proprietary hardware design as well as DCS software. And it forms a lot of the basis of how the product works. So any DAC needs to have some form of filtering inside of it to remove what's called Nyquist images from the audio. And to do that, you need to go through a process of oversampling. And a lot of these functions in modern products, what can happen is a manufacturer will choose to use a third-party chipset to carry out these functions. One of the problems that this brings is you're then limited with the performance of these chipsets. So if you're using a third-party DAC chip or a third-party SPDIF decoder chip, you can't change the behavior of that chip often, and you're limited by the filtering that they provide and the performance of that chip. With DCS, with any DCS product, we don't use any third-party chips at all. So we're using a combination of all of our own hardware design and all of our own software to carry out every function within the audio chain, from the upsampling to the filtering. All of it is DCS's own work. And so this is what forms the digital processing platform. It's all of these stages where we're carrying out any sort of DSP on the audio at all. And it gives us complete control over the performance that we can achieve from the product. A lot of this is implemented in the FPGA inside of the product. So this is true for all of the DACs, the Vivaldi units as well. All of these have FPGAs inside that carry out the core functions. The benefit of doing this with an FPGA is it means that we can provide software updates over time that can change and improve upon how the digital processing platform works. So as we saw with Lena earlier on in this year, where we introduced the preamplifier functionality to that digital processing platform, that was done by way of a free software update that came over the internet for customers. So we can provide value to people who have invested in DCS products over time. So when you're investing in a DCS product, especially with a product like Lena, which is fairly new to the market, you're really seeing it at the beginning of its journey, and the product will only continue to grow and improve from there as we release new features to the unit, be that in terms of filtering, performance updates, new streaming services that we may bring. So the processing platform makes it incredibly flexible and definitely a good long-term investment. And that digital processing platform is on all current DCS products.
So here we are in our demonstration facility. So follow me, and we have every single product the DCS manufacturer on display here. So on the top shelf here, we have our Lina network DAC, our streaming DAC, along with our Lina clock. We have our Bartok DAC here. It's got the Apex version of the Ring DAC inside, as well as the 2.0 mapping algorithm software. We have our Rossini player with its Rossini clock on the bottom shelf here. And then on the left, needs no introduction, it's our flagship Vivaldi range, which comprises of, it's a four box system. So it comprises the Vivaldi Transport, Vivaldi DAC, the Apex DAC on the second shelf down, the upsampler, which also has the network streaming capability, and our Vivaldi clock. We're gonna have a lot of fun here. We also have on display, these are the Wilson Audio Alex loudspeakers, as well as the Constellation Hercules stereo amplifier. Everything is transparent cables in here, and our products are sitting proudly on HRS racks.
Tall handsome man in a dusty black coat with a red right hand.